sky motions. Because so many things move, we need to break down the source of that motion, and then what does that actually allow us to see? So the first motion we're going to talk about is daily motion. And as the name implies, it is what happens every day. And this is due to Earth's rotation. Earth rotates once every 24 hours. And as the illustration shows, as we rotate, we're rotating west to east. And this is what causes stars, the sun, the moon, the planets, everything to rise and set. And they're always going to rise in the east and set in the west. So that is purely due to the fact that we are living on a ball that rotates. The next motion has to do with Earth's orbit around the Sun, and this is called annual motion. Annual means once a year, and that's because Earth orbits the Sun in 1 year. Now in the illustration, it's showing different constellations. And that's because in the direction towards the sun, if we look towards the sun, we would not be able to see those constellations because it would be daytime. The sun is up in the sky and it's too bright to see the stars. So for this particular position of the Earth, the stars we can see at night are going to be the ones that are opposite direction from the sun. But as we orbit around the sun, the stars that we see opposite from it change. And so what we see is that our annual motion changes which stars we see at night, or which constellations we see at night. As Earth orbits around the Sun and changes what constellations we see at night, that also means that if we could draw a line from the Earth to the Sun, we could see, hypothetically, the constellation the Sun is in front of. And if we connect a line through all the constellations the Sun passes in front of, that line is called the ecliptic. So this is the path of the sun in front of the stars. And on the illustration below, it actually labels which constellations the sun passes in front of, and those constellations probably look very familiar. Those are the horoscope constellations or the zodiac constellations. And so that's why these constellations took on importance, because the sun passes in front of them. And in fact, so does the moon and the planets. And so because all of these objects appear in front of these constellations, that's why they took on so much importance in mythology and in astrology. And presumably, your birth sign is the constellation the sun is in front of on the day you were born. However, there is an effect called precession that changes that. So odds are the birth sign that you think you are is incorrect. The sun was not actually in front of that constellation. Little side note there. Now the other thing illustrated on here, you see where Earth's axis is, this blue line is called the celestial equator. And this is an extension of Earth's equator out into space. And you see that it is tilted relative to the ecliptic. And the angle between the ecliptic and the celestial equator is equal to Earth's tilt. And we are tilted 23.5 degrees. And so that angle between the two is 23.5 degrees. Now, one of the things that does is sometime during the year, we will have the sun north of the celestial equator, and that'll be summertime. And other times of the year, the sun will be south of the celestial equator, and that will be wintertime. So that tilt of the two is ultimately what determines our seasons. Those first two motions dealt with Earth moving, our rotation and our orbit. The next motion deals with the moon. Our moon orbits the Earth, and it takes the moon 29.5 days. Roughly. And so this does two things. One, that's going to change the shape of the moon that we see. And so that's what we call moon phases. And it also changes the stars the moon is seen in front of. In our illustration here, we're starting at new moon. From our point of view, the moon would be seen in front of the sun. So that means the moon is up during the daytime. We actually won't see a new moon because its dark side is facing towards Earth. But as the moon orbits, each day it moves a little farther from the sun. We're going to see more and more illumination, but we're also going to see it in front of different stars. So as the moon orbits, over the course of a month, we will see it pass in front of all of those zodiac stars. And so every month, the moon moves along the zodiac in front of each of those constellations for a couple days each, roughly. 12 zodiac constellations, roughly 30 days. So you're looking at a little over 2 days per constellation. And so our moon is in constant, very obvious motion. Every night you go out, The moon is clearly in a different location and has clearly changed in shape. In addition to the moon being in motion, the planets are also in motion. All the planets orbit the sun. The ones closer to the sun orbit faster. And so they're all moving at different speeds. So from our point of view on Earth, and here's Earth, we're going to see Mercury moving really fast around the sun. Venus, not as fast, but semi-fast. And Mars moving slower. And then, of course, we're moving too. So what we're going to be seeing is a combination of the motion of the planets and our motion affecting where we see them in the sky. But essentially what we will see is over the course of days, weeks, or months, depending on how fast the planet moves, days for Mercury, weeks for Venus, months for all the other planets, we will see the planets move in front of the stars. And that's actually where the name came from. The word planet comes from the Greek for wanderer, because the planets wander among the stars. And so we see them wandering in front of various constellations as time goes on, and depending on how fast the planet moves. The last object visible in the night sky are, of course, the stars. And we arrange the stars into constellations. Now, constellations are imaginary pictures in the sky, largely based on mythology for the ones in the northern hemisphere. And then as you get into the southern hemisphere, you start getting some constellations that are built around technology associated with the 17th and 18th century when explorers started to venture into the southern hemisphere. Constellations are sometimes called the fixed stars, and that is not because they don't move, because we see them rise and set, but the patterns don't change, at least not in a human lifetime. Now, if you lived for tens of thousands of years, yes, the patterns would change a little bit, because the stars do in fact move, but they're so far away, we don't see the motion very easily in a human lifetime. There's just a couple exceptions where stars are fairly close and moving fairly fast that we do occasionally see something change in a course of decades instead of thousands to tens of thousands of years. Now, one of the things you'll notice in this picture is these dotted lines, and these are the boundaries around each constellation. There are 88 official constellations, and their boundaries are well defined. This was all formalized by the International Astronomical Union. So every constellation butts up against another. So I just outlined Capricorn. Here we see part of Aquarius, has this funky little boop around that star, goes off to the side there. And what you see is that each constellation fits nicely against the other. But these boundaries don't always completely circle the pictures we might necessarily associate with a constellation. Often, if you look at Aquila here, there's a big empty space here that we don't associate with the image of Aquila, the eagle, and yet those stars are considered part of that constellation. So when we say, for example, in this image, Pluto is in Sagittarius, it means it's somewhere inside that boundary that we have defined as being Sagittarius. And so here the Sun is on the boundary between Capricorn and Aquarius. So that's what it means when we say a planet is in a constellation. It means it's inside that boundary somewhere. Or when the Sun is in Aquarius. That's what that means. So these are the constellations. These are the stars that are going to rise and set every day. But the patterns will not change.